to complete signing on. Well, let's get started. Thank you all for joining us. I know everyone's busy. Thanks for taking the time to join this discussion tonight. Welcome to tonight's talk, which is part of the ongoing series, Engaging Racism, Conversations for Change, which is co-sponsored by the Tallahassee Chan Center and Florida State University's Social Justice and Innovation Lab. My name is Geeta Vijayasinghapitta. I'm a member of the Tallahassee Chan Center. It's my pleasure to be your MC for tonight. Tonight's talk deals with a very important and timely topic, racism in healthcare. Haves and have-nots. I'm sure you'll all agree that this past year has made us all acutely aware of how very important good health is. We've also become aware that not all groups in America have equal access to healthcare. And there's a disparity in mortality and morbidity rates among different groups in America. So it's very fortunate that we have our speaker who specializes in this topic of healthcare disparities. Our speaker tonight is my good friend and former colleague while I was working at Florida A&M University before I retired, Dr. Cynthia Hughes Harris, who is the Dean of the School of Allied Health Sciences at Florida A&M University, or FAMU as we usually call it. Dr. Harris leads the school with a number of allied health programs, including physical therapy, occupational therapy, respiratory therapy, health informatics, healthcare administration, and health science. She has been very active in spearheading many initiatives to address health disparities, especially in the African American community. She has served as principal investigator for several federally funded initiatives, including a multi-million dollar grant from the National Institute of Health to research community empowerment as a means of addressing health disparities in both rural and urban communities. She's also received federal funding to increase the number of students from underrepresented minorities who succeed in the health professions. Dr. Harris has served on the boards of several organizations, including the National Society of Allied Health and the Association of Schools of Allied Health Professions. She's the current research chair for the FAMU Medical Marijuana Research Initiative, and she serves on the board of directors of the Consortium on Medical Marijuana Clinical Outcomes Research, which is housed at the University of Florida. She is also engaged at the local level here in the Big Bend as a member of the board of directors of the Big Bend Area Education Commission. In that capacity, she oversees the development of approaches to address diseases that disproportionately affect underrepresented minorities. Dr. Harris has presented health disparities research to legislative groups as well, including the Black Caucus of State Legislators and the Hispanic Caucus of State Legislators. So as you can see, we're really fortunate to have Dean Hughes Harris with us tonight. It's now my great pleasure to introduce to you Dean Cynthia Hughes Harris. Dr. Harris, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Dr. Pitcher. Thank you for generous words. You know, being introduced always makes you kind of queasy, but I lived through the introduction, Gita. Thank you so very much. And thanks also to Guagu, to Dr. Berry, to the Tallahassee Chan Center, to the Social Justice and Innovation Lab for this invitation to speak. I must say, it's quite an honor. This series that's being sponsored provides such an important platform, a platform for discussion and for growth within our community. So let me just add a little bit more, Gita, if I may, to the introduction. Let me tell people that I'm originally from Chicago. I went to University of Illinois. I graduated with a degree in occupational therapy. I shifted from OT because I got interested in education. How do students learn this health professions information? And as I got involved in that, I got a master's degree in health professions education, and that kind of led to, okay, terrific, I'm getting closer, I'm understanding a little bit more. But then I wasn't understanding the policies that went into education. Wasn't understanding how the decisions were made, which then allowed me to move into my graduate studies in higher education health policy. Well, that sort of provided a basis for the research, some of the research that you described. After finishing graduate school, I had gotten involved with the HIV/AIDS population and some of the disparities that existed within those communities, initially in Chicago, then in New York. I went to New York City specifically because I was interested in community-based research. And in my mind, what better place to look at communities than New York City, which then allowed me to pursue discussion and studies in the HIV/AIDS arena with young high school students, and also allowed me to just develop a sense of what community empowerment means. That led me to FAMU because I also wanted that experience at an HBCU. And the experience at FAMU really allowed me to combine my administrative responsibilities as a dean to issues of health disparities. Health disparities as a focus of what's going on in society. And that resulted really in this discussion that says, you know, the haves and the have-nots, they really do exist, and race really does play a part in what we are saying and what we're doing about health. I'm going to share the screen now so we can begin looking at the slides and continue with the discussion. Because this is what we're talking about. If we think back, those who have a historical perspective on what's been happening in our nation, if we go back into the 60s, back in the 60s, there was an activist whose name was Fannie Lou Hamer. Fannie Lou Hamer said, she said it quite eloquently, she said, racism can make you sick. Fannie Lou Hamer said, I am sick and tired of being sick and tired. And she was talking about what so many Black and Brown people have felt for many, many decades. And when we share with other Black and Brown people, there's an immediate understanding of exactly what it means. Exactly what it means. And that is racism. That racism in and of itself can be exhausting. It calls attention to the fact that our world, as much now as in the past, our world has dehumanized, it has ostracized, it has even killed, and in so many ways has violated the human rights of so many major segments of our population. And well, as amazing as it may seem, we have experienced these travesties time and again, from one generation to the next. This is indeed intergenerational fatigue that's making us sick. Fatigue is real. It's not a simple fatigue. In fact, it emanates from several different sources. In one of her recent publications, Mary Frances Winters addresses what she calls Black fatigue. And I venture to say the fatigue applies in many ways to most Black and Brown racial and ethnic groups. The fatigue comes, first of all, from generations of oppression. The fatigue comes from blatant racism, blatant racist practices. The fatigue comes from ongoing stress and trauma from generation to generation. And our focus today, the fatigue comes from the ongoing, the inherited, lived experiences of disparities in our healthcare arena. Pardon me, it's not even an arena, it's arenas, our healthcare arenas. It's these sources that are intertwined, they're connected. Not one of them stands alone, but together they constitute what I'm referring to as the haves and the have-nots. Seems fitting to quote, I think, Dr. King, as we have spent the past several days celebrating his life and his contributions to society. But it's this quote, of all the forms of inequality, injustice on health is the most shocking and the most inhuman. Dr. King has said so much, so many powerful words. And as we look at what we're experiencing and talking about today, this is an extremely powerful vote. I think I said vote, and I wonder why I said that. I know why I said that, but I really did mean to say quote. Okay, as we talk about how lives matter, all lives matter, and we know that the pandemic is having such an extreme impact on members of society, especially Black and Brown members, but in actuality, all of us, as we experience, even from a distance, we experience protests, we're experiencing types of emotional pain, we're experiencing stress, anger. It's as if our collective being is falling apart. So perhaps it was true that what we thought mattered didn't matter. And perhaps it's taking some of us longer than others to accept and to recognize that what we are feeling is what Fannie Lou Hamer had already expressed. Just being sick and tired of it happening again and again. So it's not as if we didn't have enough to cope with these days. We didn't have enough to cope with, so COVID-19 comes into the picture. The haves and the have-nots, in this sense, the reality is working against minority groups. That is, Black and Brown populations are unfortunately the haves. COVID-19 is attacking minority communities in ways that could not have been previously imagined. We know that. We've all said that. I never could have imagined this. But Black and Latino populations are experiencing the highest levels of the virus. Looking at a little bit more data, a little more detail. Well, the CDC concluded years ago, and we can see it when we look at data over the past 5 or 6 decades, it's true that the health of both Black and white persons has improved in the United States, as evidenced by increases in life expectancy, declines in infant and adult mortality. And that's positive, right? That's actually good news. However, Black persons continue to have higher rates of morbidity and mortality than white persons for most indicators of physical health. Hispanic persons, American Indians, also have elevated disease and death rates for multiple conditions. This slide just simply shows the comparisons of American Indians or Alaskan Natives, of Asian persons, non-Hispanic, of African-American persons, and of Hispanic or Latino persons. Comparing all of those with white persons in terms of number of cases of hospitalizations, number of deaths, number of cases of COVID-19, number of cases of hospitalizations, and number of deaths. Look at us. You can see it there. American Indians, deaths 2.6 times. Asian, non-Hispanic, much lower. Black, 2.8 times. Hispanic, 2.8 times the number of deaths. And you can see the same characteristics as we look at hospitalizations and cases of the virus. So the role of medical care as a determinant of health is somewhat limited. Medical care, especially preventative care, early intervention, and the appropriate management of disease can play a role in health. Thus, racial and ethnic differentials in the quality and the quantity of care are a likely contributor to racial disparities in health, the health status of minority populations. Racial and ethnic differentials in the quantity and quality of care are a likely contributor to racial disparities. Compared with white persons, Black persons and other minorities have lower levels of access to medical care in the United States due to their higher rates of unemployment and underrepresentation in good paying jobs, jobs that include health insurance as part of the benefits package. How do we make sense of these differences, and how do we move forward with effective policies and research agendas to eliminate these disparities? And the real big question, how do we do this with COVID-19 eliminating one or more of us every minute of every day? We have already confirmed the data that minority populations are more affected by COVID-19 more than other segments of society. The fact is, and we know this, we hear it daily, we are bombarded with it daily, that the total impact of COVID is bigger, more astounding, more devastating, what we have seen in our lifetimes. But the reality is, the root causes of the impact of COVID and the impact of other diseases that are devastating to minority populations can be traced back to common root causes that are captured by practices guided by health disparities. What I'm saying is that COVID-19 is certainly in a class by itself. Can't deny that. Not surprisingly, the same racial disparities that we have experienced in the past really are being replicated today. H1N1, 20 years ago, a description of H1N1 in 2009 says, increased infection rates, hospitalizations, and deaths because minority groups were not able to stay at home. This is a quote from 2009. It's a quote from 2019, 20, and as we go into 2021. Once we have eliminated as we talk about other diseases, once we have eliminated the LGBTQ community from the HIV/AIDS crisis, and if we just focus on Black and Latino populations when talking about HIV/AIDS, the data reads pretty much the same. We can go through one disease after another, and we end up with conclusions as to which groups are the haves and which groups are the have-nots. Look at just a piece of the outbreak in the Navajo Nation, spread across usually Arizona, New Mexico, Utah. They had more infections in one small period of time. 1,800 out of 100,000 were of that group. African-American death rates in just three states, African-American death rates in just three states outranked the number of the percentage of the population in New York, was it? No, in Illinois. That was in Illinois, Wisconsin, and Louisiana. And again, these racial health disparities related to COVID-19 infections and deaths are in large part because many racial and ethnic minorities are employed as essential workers and lack paid sick leave. So they work even when sick. And of course, it becomes more complex as these individuals lose their jobs and they or their family members are now possibly sick, hungry, homeless, or facing the threat of homelessness. And you know what? These indeed are the have-nots. You know what else? They are also sick, tired, and fatigued. Yes, what is the result? Big and bold, health disparities are a part of our society. The primary messages that are generated in terms of COVID-19, focus on stay at home, maintain social distancing and wear a mask. Many members of our dominant minority groups are not able to adhere to perhaps one or more of these guidelines. What's the result? Our governmental systems have not addressed the plight, the situation of minority workers for the purpose of exploring approaches to making adjustments to the situation. Because if nothing changes, then nothing will change. We have to ask again, is this a form of racism? Is this then leading us to one of the root causes of health disparities? There's a colleague who's an attorney, pardon me, and a public health professional, Rakuja Yerby. He, and in fact, many others explicitly point to discrimination, particularly racism, as a root cause of health disparities. And this message is strongly reinforced in the book, Black Fatigue by Mary Frances Winters. So before we continue talking about health and the disparities in the world of healthcare, we have to take a minute. We must take just a minute to simply address race. We have to address equity and equality, and we have to define what we're talking about when we say racism. Although people have written volumes on these topics, volumes, I'm gonna give it to you in about 3 minutes, okay? So we're just gonna condense all that into 3 minutes. Race, rather easily defined as a social construct developed by dominant groups to categorize people by physical characteristics, mainly skin color. Although there really is no basis, documented basis, those who identify or were identified by whites as Black have been considered inferior to those labeled as white. Some people all around don't see that this is happening, that there's a group of people labeling and categorizing another group of people. And that in itself can sometimes contributes to the problems of inequity. I'm gonna talk a little bit about that, because when we talk about equity, we're talking about the treatment of people according to what they need, what they deserve, which is contrasted with what we more frequently refer to as equality, which connotes that we treat everybody the same, which often doesn't work. Look at this slide. This is quite honestly one of my favorite slides. The first slide depicts equality, right? There is a need. There's a need for the children to see over the fence. There's a need for resources so that they can see over the fence, so the resources are provided. Equality says all three children receive a box to stand on to see over the fence. But there's a problem, isn't there? Since the children are not the same, they're not the same, then they're same size, all of the needs are not accommodated by the equal distribution of resources. The shortest child still cannot see over the fence. The tallest child has no trouble seeing over the fence. The third child, who is also in a wheelchair, cannot see over the fence. But it's called equality because everybody got resources, the same resources. But by reallocating to achieve equity, we get a different picture. The tallest child doesn't need that resource, doesn't need a box because he sees well without it. The shortest child needs more, gets two boxes in order to see. And the third child not only gets a box, but it's an adapted box to accommodate for the additional need of the wheelchair. That is what equity is about. It's an assessment of the needs and a determination of who gets what and why. But what we're aiming for is really the third image. We're not there yet. That liberation, that's the ultimate goal. That's the goal that talks about removing the barrier. So are we talking about racism? Yes, we are. Let's talk a little bit more. I've defined it. The majority saying something about another group of people. Many believe that racism only happens on an interpersonal level, but I think it's really more insidious, more invasive, as systems and structures that favor that dominant group negatively affect subordinate groups. If it favors one group, then the other group gets forgotten, gets lost. Racism allows one group to carry out systemic discrimination, and it allows that not only through policies, but also through practices, also through what people are doing. Oh, and then there's this term called racist. It's such an uncomfortable term. Calling someone racist is saying kind of that they're a despicable person, isn't it? But unfortunately, such individuals do seem to exist. But what then is the difference between being a non-racist person and an anti-racist person? A non-racist person has kind of an inactive, passive belief that racism is wrong. A non-racist person absolutely rejects racism. The anti-racist person takes a stand, also rejects racism, but in whatever sphere of influence they have, they let it be known that they oppose racism. For example, we've all had this experience, I bet. A non-racist may not tell a racist joke, or somebody out there tells a racist joke. The non-racist person will not necessarily intervene when that joke is told, might even laugh a little at the joke, but that non-racist person will never tell a racist joke. However, that anti-racist person, not only would not laugh at the joke, that anti-racist person is the one who is going to go a step further to label that joke as inappropriate and offensive. This is what exists, and these are the groups that are interacting and making decisions about what happens next to groups within our society. Are we all racist to some extent? Some say yes. Some say we certainly are, depending on the situation. Others propose that minority group members really cannot be true racists because minority groups, Black people, do not have the power to implement policies that negatively affect subordinate groups. Black people do not have the power to implement policies that negatively affect subordinate groups. So I'm putting this out as a premise. We can agree, we can disagree. We can debate it, we can support it, we can refute it. Not here, not today, got a time limit, but something to think about, isn't it? Something to talk about. And we have to talk about it. That's part of what this whole series is about, talking about it, because no matter what, it's racism. Go back to how long people live. I am sure some of you have heard the saying that if the world gets a cold, if the world gets a cold, Black people get pneumonia. When the world gets pneumonia, Black people die. We've heard that. I've heard it forever. That kind of statement. That's the world we live in, and the coronavirus has only served to highlight this reality. Health disparities exist. Disparities in health and healthcare not only affect the groups experiencing the disparities, but in actuality, they also limit overall gains in the quality of care, as well as health for the broader population, which then results in unnecessary costs. In fact, listen to this. Listen to this. It's compelling, but it tells a story. Black people are 44% more likely to die from a stroke. Black people are 20% more likely to have asthma and 3 times more likely than white people to die from it. Black people are 25% more likely to die from heart disease. Black women are 40% more likely to die from breast cancer. Black women are 52% more likely to die from cervical cancer. 40% more likely to die from breast cancer, as I said, than white women, even though the incidence rate of breast cancer is comparable for the two groups, but Black women are more likely to die. Black women are 243% more likely than white women to die from pregnancy or childbirth-related causes. College-educated Black women have worse birth outcomes. For example, infant mortality, low birth weights, dying in childbirth. College-educated Black women have worse birth outcomes than white women who have not finished school. Black women represent more than 66% of new HIV/AIDS cases. Black men are 30% more likely, and Black women 60% more likely to have high blood pressure. Black men are 1.3 times more likely to be diagnosed with colon cancer and 20% more likely to die from it. Black people are more likely to experience psychological distress. Black infants are 3.5 times more likely to die at birth due to low birth weight. Black infants have a 2.2 times higher infant mortality rate, regardless of the socioeconomic status of the mother. Black babies are twice as likely to die from sudden infant death syndrome. Black children are twice as likely to have asthma. Black children are 56% more likely to be obese. Black children are 61% more likely to attempt suicide in high school as a result of depression. Whew, so is there any surprise when we look at the life expectancy comparisons in terms of the Black populations? No. However, the life expectancy of Hispanic women is impressive, and I'm certain that research exists that explores that phenomenon. I don't have it, but it's certainly worth looking into. These named health disparities that I just listed result in lower life expectancies for Black people than any other ethnic group. CDC data from 2019 indicated that the United States life expectancy for all races was 78.6 years. And the lowest for African Americans at 75.3 years, and even lower for Black men at 71.9 years. All compared to the life expectancy for white Americans at 78.8 years. There's also emerging research that says that Blacks and whites had the same mortality rate, nearly 100,000 fewer Black people would die each year in the United States. But as you can see, we don't have the same mortality rates. And to the surprise of some, even educated or middle-class Black people are sicker and die younger than their educated white peers. A Black person will live on average about 3 fewer years than a white person with the same income. So mention the middle class, and let me just stray just a little bit and talk at least through one slide about some of the stresses that some of our middle class populations have talked about. Watson and James conducted a qualitative study focused on middle class Black population who experienced stress. And they felt obligated to conceal because they were perceived as having, they were there, they had made it, they were in the corporate world, they were climbing. They were perceived as having overcome the barriers related to being Black in our society, that they were living evidence of success, that they had really made it, they had reached it. But here are some of their comments. These are people who are already there saying, they're stressed because there's no room for me to make a mistake. I can't make a mistake. I have to be perfect. I have to justify my reason for being in this environment. I'm on the defensive all of the time. These are real statements from middle-class working corporate Americans. I'm stressed to the max trying to fit in while also trying to be myself. Whether we like it or not, wherever we are always representing the race. And we always have to run away from those lazy stereotypes that so many people have attributed to us. So, okay, these are disparities. What's causing them? I've alluded to many aspects of it, but there are three categories that I'll try to quickly summarize. Because the environment is one of those social determinants of health, which centers around where people live. Where people live. Now, this really speaks loudly to the haves and have-nots, doesn't it? Where people live, because as we know, many poor minority populations live in compromised environments, which include, among other factors, things like not so many large supermarkets, more small stores, convenience stores with escalated prices. Now, those same neighborhoods also have more unhealthy fast food restaurants. And yeah, we know those fast food restaurants, they meet a need. Fast food is tasty, it's filling, and it's cheap, comparatively speaking. But such eating habits lead to such things as high rates of childhood obesity, in addition to those ever-present chronic conditions of high blood pressure, diabetes, and heart disease. You remember our Surgeon General of a few years ago, Dr. Regina Benjamin? She addressed it best. She addressed it with sadness. She said, your zip code should not be a better predictor of health and longevity than your genetic code. But that's what that zip code is doing. Access to quality care, another contributor to health disparities. Even though the Affordable Care Act has contributed to a good number of improvements. Between 2013 and 2015, for example, disparities did narrow for both Black and Hispanic populations on three key indicators: the percentage of uninsured working age adults, the percentage who did not seek care because of cost, and the percentage who did not have a primary care provider. The Affordable Care Act helped make those things better. Uninsured rates for both Black and Latino populations decreased under the Affordable Care Act. Okay, yes, these gains started to show statistically significant declines. I'm going to read it, then there won't be any emotion. Under the Trump administration, and we certainly don't have to elaborate on that fact at this point in time. End. All that to say is that health disparities are subject to the whims of politics and political ideologies. that fatigue we're talking about, we can't be ever sure of knowing it's going to go away, because gains that can be made under one heading can be lost under another. I have to talk about health insurance too. Health insurance is a part of access. It's an issue and it's a major determinant of whether and when people get the necessary medical care, where they receive care, and just generally how healthy people are. However, minority populations, I said this earlier as a reminder, the have-nots are disproportionately represented among those without health coverage. Compared with the insured, the uninsured are less likely to have a regular doctor or to get timely and routine care, and are more likely to be hospitalized for preventable conditions. So we can pretty easily conclude that expanding health insurance is of particular interest as we address health disparities. A quick slide indicates that white populations, multiracial populations, and Asian Pacific Islander populations are well below the national average of those who are uninsured, while African Americans, American Indians and Alaska Natives, and Latinos are well above the national average. Again, those who have, those who don't have, what can we say? As we think about health insurance and how it contributes to this healthcare dilemma, keep in mind that the lack of health insurance among minority Americans is usually because, and I said this earlier, it's not offered through their jobs. It's also true that unrelated to work status, minority Americans are still more likely than white Americans to be uninsured. Hence, Medicaid, government support enters the picture, which thrusts health disparities in the United States into the political discussions of the day. Some of the outcomes. Okay, continued discussion of contributors to health disparities. And remember, I said a lot of what the have-nots are experiencing is intergenerational. And that gets us to the big one. It gets us to distrust. Yep, we can talk about access, we can talk about environment, we can talk about health insurance, but distrust is always there. There's such a long history of discrimination and exploitation of Blacks and other marginalized groups. Again, a lot of the information we have is intergenerational. We may not have experienced it directly, but we know about it. We have heard about it. Our parents, grandparents, great-grandparents told us about it, and our children's children will know about it. They will know that during the antebellum periods, Blacks were forced to serve as subjects for dissection. They will know that graves were robbed and Blacks during the periods of slavery were used in extreme ways under the heading of medicine and research. They had something called drapetomania. They called it runaway slave syndrome. It was a diagnosis for a while for slaves who fled their slave masters, and the treatment for that diagnosis was amputation. And then there are multiple stories of extreme abuses among slaves under the heading, as I said, of medicine and research. And we have to think about this too, because as an aside, it parallels in many respects the same extreme practices that were performed by Nazi soldiers on captured Jewish populations. Again, a perceived dominant group exercising power over another group, primarily due to genetic differences. But to continue with historical examples, during the Reconstruction period, white doctors proposed, this is great, that former slaves would not be able to thrive in a free society because psychologically, their minds really couldn't handle freedom. So for their own good, slaves should just remain enslaved. It's logic for you, right? 100 years later, even during the civil rights era, doctors labeled civil rights activists as schizophrenic, hostile, paranoid. And maybe that's another clue as to why Black people to this day have an aversion to acknowledging mental health concerns. But we know, don't we? When we talk about distrust, we know what comes to mind. We know, everybody knows. That's Tuskegee Syphilis Study of 1932 comes to mind when we talk about distrust. Government researchers recruited 600 Black men with the advertisement, free blood tests, free treatment. Without their consent, they were administered syphilis and they were denied treatment. They were observed and then they died. Neither they nor their families had been informed. And it wasn't until 1972 when the study was exposed and finally shut down. Those cells there, those are Henrietta Lacks's cells. Henrietta Lacks was a 30-year-old African-American woman diagnosed with an aggressive form of cervical cancer. Although she died from the disease, she had very special cells. The cancer cells then lived on. The researchers allowed them to live on. They nurtured those cells. They were cultured on a mass scale and they became known as HeLa cells. They were referred to as immortal cells. And the cells have been critical to multiple medical breakthroughs. But they were taken without her consent, without the family's knowledge or consent. And when the family finally got wind of this, when they were finally confronted about the use of Henrietta Lacks's cells, there was a major apology that was given. That was it, a major apology. There's a book called Medical Apartheid, The Dark History of Medical Experimentation on Black Americans from Colonial Times to the Present. It's a heavy book, it's big, thick too. Harriet Washington wrote it, and she argues that racial discrimination has shaped both the relationship between white physicians and Black patients and the attitudes of Black people towards modern medicine in general. She addresses the cultural memory of medical experimentation and the complex relationship between racism and medicine. And with all of this being said, is it a surprise that COVID testing, let alone the COVID vaccine, that they were not and are not readily accepted by the Black community nationwide? Again, we've heard the stories. They're intergenerational stories. Washington's book, that Medical Apartheid that I mentioned, frequently explores the way in which white doctors display a lack of empathy when treating minority populations. Different approaches when treating the white middle class than when treating Black and other minority patients. One study reviewed the numbers of patient charts, just looked at the charts to determine if there were any differences between those charts of white patients and those charts of Black patients. And you know what they found? A couple of things. One, the charts of Black patients were considerably thinner. Not as much was written about the treatment plan or the treatment or the approach. Had less information indeed than comparable charts of white patients with the same diagnosis. And the other interesting part, in the charts of those Black individuals, it was mentioned more frequently than most other points of information that the individual was Black. Repeatedly referenced in their chart. Not just that beginning sentence, this is a Black 46-year-old male with the, but the Black person, the Black man, the Black person, the Black woman was mentioned more often than not in those charts. Their conclusions in this particular study epitomized the longstanding gap that really does exist in the care between white and Black patients. It's unfortunate because we really all know that the effectiveness of medical care depends largely on the quality of the medical encounters and more specifically on the provider-patient relationship, right? We've got to have the relationship with the doctor. Historically now, the physician or the provider has been the authority and the patient has been the compliant follower. Now that's changed a lot over time. The health decisions are now more jointly discussed and determined, except race all too frequently complicates the doctor-patient relationship, which could then affect decisions regarding treatment plans and protocols. Physicians much too frequently stereotype their patients, and there's considerable research that confirms this. In some cases, perhaps too many cases, it may be that doctors often stereotype African-American patients or other minority groups as being pick a category, less educated, less informed, lower class, whatever their mind is telling them about this person that they are interacting with. The relationship between the patient and healthcare provider is complex. It certainly requires more attention than I'm giving it today. But one thing we know is that the ongoing goal, and we're seeing some successes here, is to increase the number of health professionals in medically underserved areas. It is still true, though, that members of racial and ethnic minority groups remain underrepresented, but it's getting better. So it follows that health professions education can and should include more opportunities for students, for interns, for practitioners to increase their communication skills, to increase their cultural understanding, increase cross-cultural experiences with the wide variety of populations that make up our country. Oh, do we have any solutions? I don't want to even venture towards saying I have the solution. I don't. I have some thoughts of where we might go from here. Although attention to racial and ethnic disparities in care has increased among policymakers, et cetera, there's little consensus on what can or should be done to really reduce these disparities. But generally speaking, based on congressional initiatives that have emerged primarily through the NIH, there are four broad categories, four broad policy areas that have been identified. One is to raise the public and the provider awareness of racial and ethnic disparities in care. Perceptions of a problem often influence the actions that are taken, or for that matter, not taken, to change policy and practices. If people are not aware that the problem exists, then clearly the problem remains. There is research, recent and spanning the last 10 years, that reinforces the belief that African Americans and Latino populations receive the same care as white Americans. And this is not true, but behaviors will remain the same if we don't change the perception. Okay, I know, easier said than done. A second possibility, expand health insurance coverage, which I've already talked about. Minority Americans, much less likely to have health insurance. Certainly, Medicaid is a type of a safety net, but only with the caveat that it too can and should be expanded, and other sources of coverage should be added. A third possibility, improve the capacity and number of providers in underserved areas. There have been efforts to increase the number of health professionals in these regions, some indicators of success, as I've said, but the fact is that members of ethnic minority groups are still underrepresented in the healthcare workforce. One outcome is that there are fewer healthcare options, therefore, in minority communities, which leads to more individuals from minority groups relying on places like outpatient centers, emergency rooms, rather than having a doctor's office to go to, where there are opportunities for continuity and patient-centered care. We should also remember that cultural and communication barriers are less prevalent when healthcare providers reflect the population that they're treating. We know that. And then the fourth possibility, increase the knowledge base on causes and interventions of health disparities to reduce those disparities. Efforts are certainly underway. Awareness programs, such as the one we're involved in now, others that are occurring across the country in learning environments, community agencies, healthcare facilities, to really achieve success or just see progress in this area will require routinely collecting, analyzing data on healthcare across racial and ethnic groups. Such data are needed to gain a true understanding of the problem and the impact of healthcare interventions. Yes, we need more research to create new knowledge to provide the basis for the action plan. So, as we conclude this discussion, we might revisit the premise of how important life is, no matter what group we belong to. But it also might help us reframe a few of our points of view. We might be able to change the narrative somewhat. from being an underserved minority is exhausting. Change that to racism. Racism is exhausting. Not because I'm an underserved minority, but racism is exhausting. From Black people or whatever minority group name you want to put there are more prone to certain diseases. It's inevitable. Move from that. Systemic racism affects my health. I need to understand more about the supremacy of whites, white supremacy and its influence on my well-being. I can't internalize it. I have to work to understand it. Change from I don't have time for self-care to there should be and is at least one thing I can do for me every day to lessen the stress of living while Black. I do not go to doctors because I don't trust them. Move from that. I will seek out a Black doctor or a Hispanic doctor or an Asian doctor or American Indian doctor, whatever, with whom I might feel more comfortable. And then when the doctor says, I have, question those results. Question the recommended treatment. Get a second opinion. Get a third opinion. Do your own research. Ooh, conclusions. This is it, folks. I promise you, I am at the end. I have so little else to say. The topic of racism and healthcare in today's society is vast. There is no way to cover the many parameters during a short session, but the topic is so complex that I felt compelled to address several different aspects of it. We know that racism is how significantly it contributes to health disparities, and not all of them are correlated with socioeconomic status, as many people seem to think. The vicious cycle of racism that leads to ill health is staggering. Strategies to health and the bounce back from pain are important, but they fail to dismantle the system that causes the pain. Yes, we have to come together as a society to find the keys that open the interlocked systems that are so tightly bound in the history of oppression and violence that there seems to be no way to loosen them, let alone to unlock them. But I will add what a colleague has written that we are obligated to do. We are obligated to do so by our race, by our ethnicity, by our gender, by our cultural persuasion, by our sexual persuasion, by our religion, by our political party, by our age, by everything that defines us in society today. We are obligated. We are obligated to continue this movement towards help for all. Can it be said any more eloquently than James Baldwin said? Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for this opportunity. Let me just quote, the facts speak for themselves. James Baldwin, the past is all that makes the present coherent. Thank you so very much. Okay, I've done what I came to do. Thank you so very much for this opportunity. And I think we are open to your thoughts, any comments, your questions, whatever comes next. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hughes-Harris. This was really a tour de force of what is wrong with healthcare when it comes to the haves and have-nots. You touched on so many different aspects of the genesis of healthcare disparities, and they really are very disturbing. I want to encourage people to put their questions for Dr. Harris in the chat. And also, if you have questions that are too complex to write down in the chat, raise your hand and unmute yourself and ask directly.
So, and Dr. Pitter, let me also say, I'd like, questions are great. I'd also like to hear, you know, other people's thoughts and comments too.
Okay, great. So please put your questions or thoughts in the chat and I'll read them or raise your hand. As people are writing their questions, Let me ask something. I was really interested in some of your work, Dr. Harris, on community empowerment. Are there, in the research you've done regarding community empowerment, are there some special takeaways that you'd like to share with us that you found?
Yes, thank you. Thanks for that question. The community, for the most part, and I'm generalizing, does not trust the outsider. So one of the major messages really has to do with the outsider has to become a part of the community. And community empowerment says the empowerment cannot be me, the outsider, me, the professor, me, as one community person said so eloquently, you all are trying to get that thing you call tenure, and it has nothing to do, we don't even know what that's about, so, you know, we don't care. Now, we'll tell you what you really need to know. You need to know that that store down there has rats and roaches in it, but that's the only store we got, and they went on from there. But the point being that the community truly knows what its weaknesses are, knows where it wants to go and what it needs to get there. And what they're asking for is help to get there. They're not asking anyone outside of the community, tell us what we need. The community knows what it needs. The empowerment piece is to give them those resources that allow them to have the equitable box to stand on to get to the liberated place that is meaningful to them. So in my mind, community empowerment is truly the opportunity for the community to identify what resources they need and to use them in the way that they know they should be used. Given that opportunity, my experience with the community is they will indeed ask for help if needed. And that's okay, because they're asking for help. They're not, help is not being thrust upon them.
That's a really important distinction and insight. Thank you. So the questions are coming in. There's several comments about how useful and insightful your presentation was. Here's a question. Are the concepts you presented taught in medical schools? Mm. Do medical schools teach about these issues of healthcare disparities?
I don't think we can generalize from medical schools because they all approach it differently. I think the really short answer is no. But I don't think it's an absolute no. And that question, I'll tell you, is what I said at the beginning when I was introducing myself. One of the things that got me moving into higher education and health professions education was, how are those decisions made? Well, the problem with medical school is there is, in many of them, an awareness of the need for their students and their graduates and the future physicians to be sensitive to and aware of disparities and to be able to intervene so that the healthcare provider, the physician, and the patient are able to communicate and move towards a treatment plan that is reasonable. But what interferes with that? Typically, it's a fiscal thing, isn't it? And it's an accreditation thing. So the medical schools that have said, we're going to train physicians to meet the needs of minorities, and we want those physicians to go out and work in the community. And that is admirable. It makes a lot of sense. The fact is, they don't make much money in those communities. So it goes to, how do we equalize the outcome of what the physician reaps from his or her contribution to minority communities that really the physician is saying, I have to pay medical school bills. I have all of that tuition money to pay back. And I, as much as I want to help, et cetera, et cetera. So I have been and seen a number of medical schools where they have adjusted the curricula to make certain medical students have opportunities to learn about cultural communication and increase their cultural awareness and sensitivity and have experiences during their training that takes them into the communities. I have seen that. So the answer to that question is yes, medical schools can and do incorporate that. But it's what happens after that. Let me back up though. The medical school is also kind of forced to meet the accreditation standards of the American Medical Association, which don't necessarily say you're getting extra points for that cultural sensitivity. It doesn't necessarily say that. Now, the medical school may be able to intertwine that so that it still meets the accreditation standard, but that's really what that medical school is about, making sure that the standards are met. Yes, they do incorporate more medical schools are incorporating more experiences for students to, as I said, have those cultural experiences. But they graduate and here's that one graduate who, you know, takes a residency in orthopedics and another one who takes that residency in community-based practice. And when they meet 10 years later, and this is a real story. A community-based general practitioner who said he went to Las Vegas with his medical school buddies. And it was kind of like, oh, really? Did you have fun? What'd you do? And he's like, yeah, it was pretty good. But, you know, I'm a general practitioner. They're high rollers. They were doing things I could not afford to do as a physician because his practice was not as lucrative, shall we say. I think he was very comfortable saying, I think I'm happy, as happy or happier. But in terms of the financial output, that was a problem.
Thank you. More questions have come on in. Actually, there's a couple of comments first. Say the one says we've all heard things that for many years, and so many times what the speakers proceed to say is something I'm hearing for the first time. It seems there's an assumption that we all have the same information, but at least in my case, this isn't true. It's good we're having this discussion so we can put all this information on the table for us all to look at. Here's a comment, actually a suggestion from someone. The book, Medical Apartheid, The Dark History of Medical Experimentation on Black Americans from Colonial Times to the Present, is a great read.
Yes.
Okay, here's a question.
Sitting here somewhere.
Appreciate your presentation so much. Thank you. Out of the three cases of disparities, distrust stood out as something that I've noticed in my interaction with Black and Brown people. Your fourfold solutions are focused on policies. So question is, how do distrust relate to policies? Mm-hmm. Perhaps it's indirectly. Mm. Are there ways you would suggest to build trust on an interpersonal level?
That is that's a million-dollar question. Wouldn't I be great if I could say, yes, what you should do is. and I really can't answer that. Keep in mind that things are interwoven and intertwined. Distrust stands out. And it's similar to what I just said in terms of community empowerment. We have to get in there. And demonstrate that we are trustworthy. You know, trust is something that's earned. And the story of the Affordable Care Act, it worked for a while until the next guy comes along and attempts to dismantle it. So why should I get excited about it? Why should I do it? It's not going to perhaps change. And yes, someone says, what about the insurance industry? Is that a money-making scheme or what? Far be it for me to say, but we do know that the cost of having insurance is a hefty cost. But we also know the connectivity between insurance coverage and the type of job one has. So going back to the original question, how do we minimize distrust, I think is the bottom line of that question. And I think we can have a whole long discussion on that because it's complex and some have tried and some have even succeeded, but more people who say, trust me, who look like me, is going to be more successful than somebody who I already don't trust, who says, trust me, and looks like somebody else. It's got to start with having more people like us involved with us.
Good point. There was a second part to that insurance question.
Yes.
And the person asked, is participation in the Affordable Care Act different for Blacks versus whites of the same socioeconomic status?
No, there's not a socioeconomic distinction, no.
Oh, so it's similar?
Yes.
Oh, great. Here's a question from Guagu. He says, would you please share your notes references about the medical mistreatment of Blacks during the antebellum and civil rights periods?
Yes, it's definitely.
And because he'd like to look into that. So if you could send us those references.
A colleague of mine, who's actually a physician in Cleveland, and we're talking and I'm telling him about this discussion presentation and such. And he actually sent me a really great article not too long ago, which I referenced during this discussion. So I'll send that to you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Oh, here's a comment from William Hudson. I just have to say, so I can say hi to him. He says, thank you, because your presentation will help him make a similar presentation later. I thought that was
anything I can do, sure. Anything.
Okay, Guagu's put in the chat some links to relevant articles.
Oh, great. I saw him put in
those articles about apartheid.
Yeah, that's been, I'm surprised it's not like right in front of me right now, because it's that book has been with me since we agreed that today would be the day we do this. But anyway, it's not in my realm of vision, but it's a great exploration of all that we're talking about.
Yeah, that would be really interesting. Mm-hmm. I have a question. So as we've explored this, it seems that there's so many pieces to this, and this issue of policies changing with each administration, it seems to be one of the many problems. Do you get a sense that there might be enough momentum building up in society to not make those policies go away every 4 years? Is there enough understanding, particularly in the health professions, that they would advocate strongly enough?
I personally think so. I really do. I mean, think of, I'm sorry, it's, what happened? I lost you.
You see me?
No, my, I saw that my charge was going down, so I lost you. I have a, anyway, I think that there is a possibility, Gita, because think of things like Social Security. Even though there's a lot of buzz right now that doing away with Social Security, but it has lasted for decades and decades, right? In spite of political changes and different ideologies and different persuasions actually in Washington. So I think that it is possible, yes. It's that movement from one set of people who think a certain way, who implement certain policies, and the ability for the American public really to make certain that that continues. So I do think it's possible, but it's especially, you know, times are, we're just in a difficult time. I don't, not one of us knows what we can hold on to today that we, what we can hold on to today that won't be gone tomorrow.
Other people have questions? Because if you don't, I could go on and on. Anyone else have questions? Well, here's a question while I'm looking for more questions in the chat. I thought it was really interesting what we're hearing about the role of stress, the stress of racism that really affects the health of African Americans. I think we're just beginning to understand the role of stress. Mm-hmm. And I think it explains a lot of things that people in general seem to just attribute to some problem with the person having the illness. You know, they tend to say, oh, this person is not doing such and such, or, you know, this group is not doing such and such. They tend to place the responsibility and the blame on the people actually having the problem.
Right.
Do you feel that there is in the health professions now a growing, more complex understanding of how all these different factors, including the pervasiveness of racism in the workplace, in every facet of our lives, is really impacting health? And it's not just that the individual is not doing the right things.
I can only agree with you, Gita. I'm not sure what the question is that I can answer, though. I can say there are different approaches that a physician has to different kinds of people. And I really don't even know if this is the realm in which you're speaking, but as you were talking, this is what came to mind. So I talked about obesity. And I'm trying to remember where this occurred. I don't know if it was a study or a story, but African-American obese woman is told by her physician, you need to lose weight. And that's it. Mm-hmm. Comes, sees that physician again or at the community center or whatever it is. You need to lose weight, I told you that. End of discussion, okay. The patient, the woman accepts that, but what does that mean to her? What does that mean? I mean, yes, she understands exercise and move more and eat differently, but her diet is her diet. What she eats is what her family has been eating for decades. You know, you put a ham hock in the greens. That's what you put in the greens. Nobody said anything about not putting a ham hock or using turkey instead of the ham hock. Nobody, that's not a part of her experience. Now, the physician in the other side of town who says to his client, you need to use weight. Oh my goodness, do I need to lose weight? Okay, I'm gonna go join the health club. I'm going to change my diet. I'm going to the store. I'm gonna buy this, I'm gonna buy, and has a plan in mind. The patient does, and the physician, by the way, says, I'm gonna set you up with a nutritionist who can help you with your diet, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The whole approach is just entirely different. Too often, just too often. Now, when we were working in Gadsden County with some of our community empowered persons, and another story of, this is kind of how you can help people. So here was a woman who told the story about, doctor said I need to lose weight. I don't know what that means. You know, this is what I do. This is what I got to do. But one of our students actually worked with this woman. This was a woman who really did not move from her house. She lived on the first floor, but kind of stairs to get to where she lived. She went to two places, the doctor and to church. Her son picked her up, got her downstairs, drove her to and dropped her off literally right in front of church or right in front of the doctor. So one of our student workers literally started her walking in her house. I mean, the goal was to get her to be able to walk from the front of her house to the back of her house, which quite honestly took a couple of months. Quite honestly, to be able to walk out of her front door and down her stairs. Quite honestly, for her son to pick her up a few houses away from where he had been picking her up, to drop her off a little further away each week from church, that her walk, her steps, if she had had a Fitbit, her steps would have increased, I mean, significantly, because of the support just in moving, just in moving. Now, nothing changed, but I mean, I won't say nothing, because there were certainly a lot of other interventions in terms of how you can change your diet and such and such. But just the increase in movement made a difference in her life that had she had been sitting for years, just been sitting for years. So I don't know what that says.
Well, it does point to the need for having enough commitment on the part of the health professionals to think and provide that kind of individualized support that people need. Mm-hmm. There is a question from April. April, are you able to unmute yourself?
Go ahead, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Hi, Dr. Harris.
Hi.
I wanted to know your opinion on, as you talked about the lower reimbursement rates and the lower salaries and understaffing and the disparity of like working in public health settings versus private practices. It seems that there's always a time increase gap, although a lot of Black and brown individuals are trying to go to school and get training and educated and degrees in these fields, the numbers still continue to triple and rise. And it just seems like we can't meet or catch up that gap. Do you have any insight or opinions around how we can make this more of a community approach and where we maybe are involving people that may not, you know, go to school, but still give them that training to where everyone can play a role in it? If you get what I'm saying, am I making sense?
I think I didn't, but that last statement, how can we increase the number of people who are contributing in different roles to address the issues that are they're being presented with. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. And that's really a sign of community empowerment that you just described. Again, some of we did the study that we did occurred in two sections of the country, one in our own rural neighborhoods of Gadsden County, and then in the urban environment of Roxbury, Massachusetts. And both of those, rural, urban, different lifestyles entirely. But what made the difference was the ability of the community groups to get together. And what I said earlier I think Dr. Pitcher's question, identify what their needs are and how we as a community group can go about making them happen. So if you add that to the question you're asking, might it be possible to identify what some of the needs are for my community? Do I need more more nurses? Do I need more teacher aides? Do I need more playground managers? Do I need more, what do we need that's going to fill some of the gaps in the community? What can we as a community do to make that grocery store meet our needs? Is there a way? And yes, there is, because money talks, and it's not possible to boycott the grocery store because that's close to us and where we shop. But as a community, maybe there's some organized approach we can have to, since you won't make your grocery store amenable to our needs, let's work together and get some of us to go to the big grocery, the Publix down, that's really not that far away, but I need lists and I need people with cars and I need people who are saying, we'll do the shopping for lots of us. That idea really just came to my mind, but I really think it's kind of a good idea to let the community take on some of its own issues. And I've seen that happen. I've seen in both of these environments that I just described, where the communities themselves had their own meetings and their own problem solving sessions, and they asked for help. And when they asked for help, we provided help. If they didn't ask, we didn't impose our thinking on the directions that they were going. So yes, I think it could happen. That's a short answer. Now, you give answers to questions and there's succinct answers. Great question, here's an answer. But it takes a lot more than that, doesn't it? It takes a lot of paving the way. One of the guys in Roxbury greeted us, and these are people from FAMU and Florida State and Harvard School of Public Health. And they were like, so you all come into our neighborhood, huh? Very good. We had been going in and out of there for months on end, 6-8 months. And one guy finally said, have you ever eaten at, I don't remember the name of the restaurant at this point, like Joe's Diner? And we're like, no, we haven't. So he said, I'm gonna tell you something. Until you all become regular customers at Joe's Diner, we're not gonna be able to do anything together. We're gonna smile at you, we're gonna nod, we're gonna be as friendly as we can be, but we're not going anywhere. Cause and it's the same thing, you're not a part of us. You know, anything that happened in that neighborhood went through Joe's Diner. Joe's Diner, if it happened there, then it was gonna take its next step. So that's about learning your community, really. That's about knowing where the trigger points are, where the influential people are, and how they can help take the steps that we're talking about. April, did that help?
Yes, ma'am. I think I was just wanting you to give me the green light, but maybe it's my
own selfish. I'm not going to do that, April, but we can talk further.
Yeah.
There's one more question, and we have run out of time. But before I read the last question, I want to remind everyone that we're going to meet at 7:30 next Tuesday to discuss Dr. Harris's great presentation and all the ideas and questions and thoughts that we would have pondered during the course of the coming week that we can discuss among ourselves. Dr. Harris won't be with us, but we can all get together in our breakout rooms and discuss some of the great ideas that we've explored today. So here's the question, the last question, from Gwagu again. In terms of accessibility to quality care and environmental causes for health disparity, it seems that federal state reallocation of resources would really better this dilemma. In your research, did you study the reallocation of resources? If so, what were some of the obstacles, challenges in reallocating resources? And then he adds, your idea of grocery shopping is inspiring me to think of possible communal grassroots assistance of Frenchtown.
Ah, yes, yes, absolutely. Reallocation of resources goes to that whole discussion of equity. People really think if you just give them some money, okay, we've increased the allocation to this community by $10,000. So look, we gave them money. What's the problem? The problem is that $10,000 is not helpful, because it's easy to spend $10,000 to meet our needs because our needs are so vast. But what we don't have is the plan for not just today, but the ten thousands of dollars that are needed over time. So that's when the community has benefited from those of us who can lay out plans. The community, again, can tell us what the needs are. They can ask, they can be very clear on how the money has been spent in the past, or how they would like for any monies that are given to them to be spent in the future. But that plan for the proposal that is being presented to the city council, or the proposal that's being presented to Congress, whatever the body is, there's a governing body that has the funding. So the real answer to the question, Gwagu, is no, I don't. I don't have a quick and easy answer as to, you know, how to get those resources that are needed, because to get them requires information. The who are we talking about? How many of the who? What are the goals to meet what needs? I mean, there's a plan that's put together that allows us to then say, if we had this, then that could happen. And that's what a lot of people are doing right now. That's what a lot of public health people, that's what a lot of allied health people, that's what a lot of health administrators, that's what a lot of health professionals, practitioners, nurses, pharmacists, doctors, everybody is really, in many respects, attempting to identify what those needs are and get the plan. The problem is, where is this plan going? Who is supposed to get it? Who's going to make the difference? And this is where funding has come in. As I say, NIH has been a really good supporter. Well, 4 years ago, NIH was a really good supporter, and hopefully in the next 4 years, NIH will be a really good supporter of really taking some of these ideas, some of the funding, and directing it towards a true community improvement in healthcare. If we do that, then the disparities can gradually diminish, can gradually decrease. But it's not just bam, it's going to happen.
Dr. Harris, Gwagu did add something to his question. So in terms of the obstacles to making these policy changes, he was asking in the research that you've done or your own experience, were there some types of obstacles that you faced repeatedly?
Well, some of them I've alluded to, and the distrust was there. In this case, the distrust was the community not trusting more researchers coming into their environment. They were so familiar with researchers, you know, and they, as they said, friendly, smile, do what you want, but we don't care what you're trying to do because you're doing it from your position, not our position. So that is certainly one area. Distrust is the biggest obstacle that existed. The only approach there, before I do that, another obstacle was they saw the different researchers, for lack of a better term, but different people from different environments and location competing with each other to get to them. You know, so, I mean, no, we're better for Gadsden County. No, we're better for Gadsden County. No, we know exactly. I don't want to get too specific when I was about to. So they watched us, and the us, I'm being very generic about it. They watched the researchers from FAMU, from Florida State, from Central Florida. They would watch us and, you know, say, yeah, you all are trying to get, you know, you like to write articles about us and you like to get this thing called tenure. And we don't care. I mean, that was the bottom line. That is not of interest to us. So that was probably one of the biggest barriers. I'm going to tell you, we spent, in that instance, we spent well over a year becoming a part of the community. Simple as that, getting them used to seeing us, getting our faces known, going to Joe's Diner and having lunch, going to the church services, becoming a part of the community so they were able to say, hi, Cindy, how you doing? You know, good, Joe, how are you doing? And we did that for a good year or more before being able to get to, let's see if we can do something else to make your lives better.
Well, thank you, Dr. Harris. This has been really a delight, though sometimes a very disturbing one.
Yes, yes.
Because of the nature of the topic. Thank you so much. We really appreciate the time you've spent with us and for sharing your thoughts, your ideas, and your experiences on this topic. So it's a real contribution to our series.
Well, again, thank you for the invitation and thanks for giving me the opportunity to talk. Gosh, that's what I do. But thank you for that. You certainly allowed me the opportunity to sort and filter. And I have another slide. And I'm just going to tell you what it says. I can't show it because I'm out of the slide sharing mode. But it says, there's more to this. My last slide said more. And there are things like, I mean, and I limited it to five different arenas, you know, that had to do with the fact that computers, there's a disconnect even in how computers are assessing. Without the human factor, there are computers that are indeed giving more or less to one racial group or another. And you know that digital divide that we really have to look at. So there's still other things that I didn't even begin to touch on that are out there.
Yes, I'm sure. Thoughts for another day.
Yes.
So it's been our pleasure, and we wish you and all the great work you're doing at FAMU well. And hopefully we'll have some opportunities to contribute to our community in the future.
Okay.
So thanks for joining us, everyone, and hope to see you on next Tuesday. Good night.
Thank you, Dr. Pitter. Thank you to all.
Thank
Glad to have
you.
A chance to meet with you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye, Guaco.
Thank you.